Hey man, the views of the John LeBay show, man, are not necessarily the views of this station, man, or their sponsors.
Over the Flint water crisis. That is happening at the same time President Obama is swooping in to declare the situation a federal emergency, giving Michigan $5 million in federal aid to immediately assist with the public health crisis, but he did deny Governor Schneider's request for disaster declaration. What's a disaster declaration, you wonder? Well, if you've been watching the local news, they should have told you, but if they haven't, here's what it is. A disaster declaration would have made larger amounts of federal funding available more quickly to help Flint residents whose drinking water is contaminated with lead and other weird and crazy things. But under federal law, only natural disasters such as hurricanes and floods are eligible for disaster declarations, and since the lead contamination of Flint's drinking water is man-made, you can't get it. So Flint's SOL right there. Those people who are so worried about the little guy are swooping in to come save the day. The president's actions authorize the Federal Emergency Management Agency, or FEMA as they are commonly known, to coordinate response and cover 70% of the costs of much-needed water, filters, filter cartridges, and other items for residents. It is capped at $5 million, though, so that's not going to do a whole heck of a lot when you know the size of the city that Flint is. $5 million is not going to last long in Flint. It's, even though it's decrepit and not a lot of people live there like they used to be, it's not the booming hub of the auto industry. There's still a lot of people that live there. So $5 million isn't going to do a whole lot. But the bigger thing is now FEMA will have to come into everybody's house. They'll have to come into everybody's house to install these filters because, of course, they have to be installed properly, I'm sure. And there is a lot of blame going around, ladies and gentlemen. You hear Governor Schneider being blamed, the emergency manager being blamed. Tons of people are being blamed for this crisis. But for the most part, the real culprit for Flint's troubles is not even being talked about. So before I get into all that, let's get on the same page in terms of what this crisis is about and how the water crisis actually began. So here's how everything broke down. An emergency manager takes over in Flint. Emergency managers begin as Governor Schneider appoints Michael Brown as emergency manager of Flint. Brown is the first of four emergency managers to take the city's reins during financial emergency. The city was in big crisis. It wasn't getting the tax revenue it needed. It was in debt, and it was heading for bankruptcy. Less than a year later, another emergency manager takes over. Governor Schneider appoints Ed Kurtz as emergency manager after Michael Brown steps down. He's a returning emergency manager of Flint. He served the city during its first financial emergency from 2002 to 2004. Flint was in big trouble multiple times, and this guy was the manager prior, and they brought him back in because he brought him out of that emergency status back in 2004, and they thought maybe he could do it again. Now we're around December 20th, 2012. Michigan Treasury officials meet with city officials to discuss drinking water options. What they did is they discussed Flint's water options using the Flint River was discussed, but it was decided that Treasury officials would study two more options, staying with Detroit Water or switching to a new source. The report comes out after two meetings. On March 25th, 2013, Flint City Council votes to join a whole new water system even though they hold no power. They wanted to go to a cheaper alternative than the Detroit water system. The pipeline would bring Flint water directly from Lake Huron, but it would not be completed for 7 years. By April 16th of that year, Flint emergency manager Ed Kurtz signs an agreement to join the new water system. Detroit's water department attempted to keep Flint as a customer, but Ed Kurtz said future rates would be too unreliable, but the new water system wouldn't be able to supply Flint with water for 2 to 5 years. On April 17th, Detroit says, you know what? Fine. If you guys want to leave us, we're gonna cut you off now. Detroit notifies Flint it will end its water contract with the city in 1 year. The new KWA pipeline will not be ready in that time, of course. The city then has to either negotiate a new contract with Detroit or find a temporary supply. This is the point at which state officials and Flint's emergency manager claims Detroit cut Flint off. By June 26th, the emergency manager hires an engineering company to plan to switch to Flint River water. This agreement is with engineering firm Lockwood, Andrews, and Newman. The agreement says LAN will figure out how to equip the Flint water plant for treatment of Flint River water, and LAN will be paid $171,000 for this. By June 28th, new water pipeline project breaks ground near shores of Lake Huron. Genesee County officials say the KWA pipeline will help balance water rates that Flint will eventually get water from. On June 30th of 2013, emergency manager Ed Kurtz resigns. He quits. He says, you know what? I'm out of here. I don't want to deal with it. He saw something coming down the pike, and he says, I'm getting the heck out of here. Kurtz leaves office when the fiscal year closes at the end of June. He had announced he planned to resign a month earlier. Michael Brown becomes Flint's emergency manager again. This is the second time Brown serves as Flint's state-appointed emergency manager in this same financial crisis. He was first appointed in 2011. On September 11th, 2013, oddly enough, 911, emergency manager Michael Brown resigns. He's like, I'm out of here. He saw what was going on and he got the hell out too. After 3 months on the job, Brown will leave office at the end of the month, citing family issues as his reason. Sure. Darnell Early becomes Flint's next emergency manager. So now they have a third guy in one emergency situation. A third dictator already. After a stint as temporary mayor in 2002, Early returns to Flint as the new EM. So he was at least familiar with Flint, you know. Early turns down Detroit's offer to continue to buy its water. He says, no. No. In a letter to Detroit's water and sewage department, Early says Flint is expected to get its water from Flint River and there is no need to continue to purchase water from Detroit. See, he didn't know what was going on yet. The other two guys got out and they didn't say anything. On April 9th, 2014, the state environmental regulators approved permits that allow the city to switch to Flint River. Because the city was temporarily going to use the Flint River as their water source until they got the new water in from the new pipeline. Not a good idea, I guess. April 25th, 2014, the switch was made. Flint starts getting its drinking water from the Flint River. This marks the end of an almost 50-year-long stream that Lake Huron water traveling from Detroit to Flint. So they got a month in, month and a half in at best. June 1st, not even a month and a half, month and a week, Flint residents start complaining about the smell, taste, and discoloration of the water almost immediately. It didn't take long. Many say it makes them sick. So you're getting discolored water and it smells funny. Why are you drinking it? On August 14th, Flint water tests positive for E. coli. Flint issues several boil water advisories 2 days later. It took them 2 days. 2 days. Not immediately. It took them 2 days. Positive total confirmation tests are an indication that people might be exposed to the harmful pathogen. On October 13th of 2014, the GM Motor Engine Plant announces it will stop using Flint water. To help eliminate contaminants, Flint adds additional chlorine to its water. But GM worries that the treated water will cause corrosions in its machines, and the company announced it will buy Lake Huron water from Flint Township until the KWA pipeline is finished on January 2nd, 2015. After attempting to treat for E. coli, Flint is found to be in violation of the Safe Drinking Waters Act. The Michigan Department of Environmental Quality found unacceptable levels of TTHM, which is trihalomethanes. And this is a byproduct of Flint water chlorination and disinfection process. Over time, the EPA says elevated levels of TTHM can lead to an increased risk of cancer and other health problems. Things kept growing, getting worse and worse. January 6, 2015. Officials say the water in Flint is safe to drink. At a news conference, Flint Mayor Dwayne Walling tells reporters the city's water is safe to drink. January 9th, University of Michigan Flint finds some water samples on campus are high in lead. I thought it was safe to drink, folks. At the time, residents thought it was an isolated problem. The university closed some of the infrequently used drinking fountains as a result. Because that's going to stop lead. January 11th, 2015. Emergency manager Darnell Early says Flint will not return to Detroit's water. Even though E. coli, lead, discoloration, smell, people getting sick. January 13th, emergency manager Darnell L. Early leaves office and Jerry Ambrose comes in. Another guy leaves. He's like, ugh. He sees the writing on the wall. He tells everybody it's okay and then leaves. Sounds like the other two guys, right? Governor Snyder announces Early will become emergency managers of Detroit public schools after a 15-month stint in Flint. Because you know what? He was doing such a great job in Flint. Why not send him down to the Detroit schools, which we have plenty to talk about there? He can save it all. And then we've got the Detroit teachers, of course, wanting to go on strike because a lot of things are going bad in Detroit. They've got some really terrible conditions in these schools. And again, they had to send the guy from Flint, who was failing up there, and they sent him down to be the emergency manager of the schools in Detroit. And they expect that stuff to get better. I don't get it. I don't get it. That's the way things are. And teachers want to go on strike about it because of the poor conditions. But who cares about the kids, right? Unless you want to keep the kids home because it's safer to keep them home. Maybe that's what they want to do. But listen, if it's that bad, here's what you do. Close the schools. Close all the schools. The kids are better off not going to these schools and having a chance to get health issues. I mean, I'm sorry, they may not be able to go to school somewhere, but if there's a chance they might get sick because of the poor conditions, or they might get hurt at school because of the poor conditions, you know what? It's better to keep them home and say, you know what? School's closed in Detroit, folks. Nothing to do. And that way the teachers don't have to go on strike either, and they don't have to worry about their paycheck anymore. We had this same thing here in Taylor. We had a few years back, teachers, they went and protest up in Lansing, took the days off of school so the kids didn't go to school. I mean, that's really caring about the kids, teachers. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, kids. If the teachers don't want to go to school and educate because they're more concerned about something else, then hey, close the school down.
Don't think about touching that dial.
That would be a mistake.
The John LeBay Show will be right back. After this,
that's guaranteed, man. Like some good Thai stick.
Captain, I'm getting strange readings on my scanners.
Explain.
Captain, I'm picking up a signal.
On speakers.
Captain, the ship is decloaking.
Shields up.
Jim.
My God.
February 25th, 2015, the city test reveals high lead content in water of Flint residents' homes. In the first of several tests, Lee Ann Walters' water turns up with a lead content of 104 parts per billion. 50 parts per billion is the EPA's limit for lead in drinking water. Double. Over double. February 27th. The EPA asks questions about Flint's water treatment process. The state responds, Flint is treating the water correctly. In an email to the EPA, MDEQ Stephen Baus says Flint is an optimized corrosion control plan. Water treatment plants are supposed to add chemicals like phosphates to prevent corrosion. It is later revealed that Flint was not treating its water for corrosion. Is all this stuff happening on purpose? What is going on? It seems like this stuff is happening on purpose, right? 2003, Flint City Council votes to do everything possible to reconnect with the Detroit water system. This decision is made in a 7-1 vote. 7-1. One guy was against it. That guy should be thrown out. April 2015. Flint resident Lee Ann Walters discovers her child has lead poisoning. The city eventually discovers the family service line to the Flint water system is the source of the lead. Officials shut off the service line and connected the family to a neighbor's garden hose. That's their solution. Flint's in big trouble, folks. April 29th, Flint financial emergency is declared over. Emergency manager Jerry Ambrose leaves office. A receivership transition advisory board now oversees council and mayoral decisions in Flint. June 23rd, judge rejects injunction to force a switch back to Detroit Water. A coalition of Clean Water, composed of Flint Pastures and several others, file a suit in response to problems associated with Flint River water. And a judge says no. Do you not see how this seems to be all on purpose? Are they trying to drive people out? I don't know. June 24th, 2015, a leaked memo reveals EPA experts concerned about lead in Flint's water. The memo written by the EPA discusses the extremely high lead levels in Lee and Walter's home. EPA spokesperson says federal regulators have not yet had a chance to verify and assess the extent of the issue. Government failing on all levels. City, state, federal. Failing on all levels. In reaction to the EPA's memo, state spokesperson tells people to relax. This is June 10th. Relax. When talking to Michigan Radio's Lindsey Smith, Brad Werfel says, quote, anyone who is concerned about lead in the drinking water in Flint can relax. It does not look like there is any broad problem with the water supply freeing up lead as it goes in homes. Unquote. August 20th, the state revises a city report and invalidates two water samples. High in lead. The drop samples resulted in the city meeting federal standards. What the heck is going on for lead? So they drop two results. It's just, sounds like the guys over doing the weather control. Michigan Radio explains how dropping two Flint water samples kept the city below the federal action level for lead in water. One of the samples dropped was from Lee Ann Walter's house. The one that had the lead poisoning in her kid. You know, that one don't count. Nah, that one don't count, you know, because it was the house's fault. Not the city water. That's not the fault. State officials say the sample was dropped because the home had a water filter which could have lowered the result. The Walter sample was the highest lead test result in the sampling pool. Folks, government failing on all levels. All levels. And this, I mean, if you're thinking, We're only up to August 20th of last year. And on all levels, I'm sitting here going, this seems like it's being done on purpose. September 19th, 2015, Virginia Tech University's research finished testing water samples from 300 Flint homes. Mark Edwards and other Virginia Tech researchers find high levels of lead across the city. Water samples from Lee Ann Waters' house are highest in lead content. One sample was as high as 13,200 parts per billion. 15 parts per billion is the EPA limit, and the levels at 5,000 parts per billion above are considered hazardous waste. September 24th, 2015, Flint pediatricians find lead levels in children in Flint area rising. Say water could be poisoning kids. Lead levels in Flint children have gone up since Flint switched to the river water. Prior to the switch, 2.1% of kids in Flint had elevated blood levels of lead, while now 4% do. September 20th. Rick Snyder says some mistakes were made in the switch to Flint River water. Some mistakes. Governor Snyder admits the switch to river water was planned poorly. Things were not fully understood, Snyder said. In that large of an operation, that important, the city's water, not every precaution was taken. There wasn't double and triple checking, making sure everything was perfectly done. This is water, folks. This is important. October 1st, 2015, Genesee County declares public health emergency after Flint issues lead advisory. This comes in response to high levels of lead found in children. The city plans to distribute thousands of water filters, because that's going to cure it. October 2nd, the day after. MDEQ Director Dan Wyatt claims Flint used corrosion controls when switching to Flint River water. This statement conflicts with what was said previously. Flint was not implementing corrosive controls. October 6th, 2,400 water filters are dispersed to Flint residents. As part of its action plan, state hands out 20,000 water filters, while the Genesee County Health Department with United Way contribute an additional 4,000. October 8th, Governor Snyder announces the city will switch back to Detroit's water system. The switch will cost them $12 million. The state and the Moat Foundation will contribute $10 million to help pay for Flint's switch back to Detroit's water. Flint will pay $2 million. They're hoping this is all going to go away. October 16th, Flint reconnects with the Detroit water system. Flint officials say it will take approximately 3 weeks for Detroit water to fully replace Flint River water. It is unknown how quickly lead levels will return to normal. November 3rd, Dwayne Walling loses re-election bid for city mayor. November 13th, Flint residents file class action lawsuit against the state of Michigan and the city of Flint government employees. The lawsuit addressed the personal injury and property damage Flint residents face as a result of the Flint switch to Flint River water. Plaintiffs say they deal with various health problems thanks to the former water system. December 15th, new mayor Karen Weaver declares a state of emergency in Flint. 3 weeks for the water and a month has gone by now. Weaver says the drinking water in the city has caused irreversible damage to the health of the children in the city. All right, folks, I know that was long-winded, and we still don't really know who to blame. There's a lot of people that we talked about, and a lot of shady things been going on. But who is really to blame? Well, when I get back, I'll clue you in. And it's a doozy. You won't believe it.
Where do you think you're going?
Hey, man, don't go anywhere, man. The John LeBanc Show will be right back.
Are you crazy?
Powerful, epic music by Toothbox Row. Life-changing lyrics come in every style, empowering humanity to finally unlock the chains of bondage. Experience the edgy side of positive music and rock your world today. From Primal to Divine, available now at sassyalternativemusic.com.
And now, the moment you've been waiting for. Top 10 Artists 23 EXP releases their 11-song debut album, Welcome, featuring songs like Siren, This album is guaranteed to satisfy your hunger with songs like Food, How We See It Taken Away, Welcome by EXP is available right now at CD Baby, Amazon, Spotify, Pandora, and wherever music is sold. And yes, this album includes the number one song, Stand Up. Welcome by 23 EXP. Get it today.
The monster that's inside.
And allow me to do a little bit of self-promotion. If you want to contact the John LeBang Show, you can reach us at jlebang@live.com. That's jlebang@live.com. We accept your hate mail and pictures and videos and news and all kinds of wonderful stuff that you want to share with us. We'll take it. If you're interested in what we have out on the web, you can go to our website at www.jlebang.com. It's jlebang.com. You can also go to YouTube at youtube.com/lebangyourhead. And you can catch us on Twitter at John LeBang and like our Facebook page at The John LeBang Show. This half hour is brought to you by FantasyPuckheads.com. The season is underway. Keep up with all of your fantasy hockey news at FantasyPuckheads.com.
Did you know you can exercise often but undo your efforts with unhealthy eating habits? I'm Coach Drea, and I would love to help you reach your health and fitness goals, all from the privacy of your own home. My next health and fitness challenge starts soon. You get accountability, motivation, one-on-one support from me, meal planning, fitness program, 30 days of Shakeology, and more. Contact me at CoachDrea.com. That's CoachDrea.com or Facebook.com/CoachDrea. What do you have to lose?
You got a raggedy old couch? Maybe you need some vinyl for that ripped up chair or card table. Well, come on down to Shady's Fabric. We've got everything you need. Even if you need some drapes to keep that dirty old man from next door looking in on you while you're LeBanging your wife, we got that too. Maybe you have a sister-in-law that is so ugly that every time you see her, you go into epileptic seizures. Well, come on down to Shady's Fabric and we'll give you something to cover that up. That's right, Shady's Fabric. We got the best deals in town. And we also have a great cash and carry program. You carry in the cash, and then you can carry out the merchandise. Look us up on Facebook. That's Shady's Fabric. Just cover it up. Folks, welcome back. You know, I'm getting into these roles where I forget to welcome you to the show. So now that we're in the second half of the show, deep into the show, welcome to the show. Hope you've enjoyed tonight's broadcast. Hopefully it's been informative because there is a lot of information tied around this Flint water scandal. But who is to blame? Who really is to blame? Now, there are a lot of players. The problem started long, long, long before any of these emergency managers, long before this water crisis. The election of poorly qualified people for decades is the main reason for all of Flint's troubles. The loss of the auto industry, the decline in the tax base, the Flint water issue. This goes back decades. Short-sighted voters elected corrupt politicians who drained the city, which brought it to financial ruin, and the emergency manager was brought in to clean up the mess, which resulted in short-sighted decisions made under crisis management. And what was the result? More crisis. Who's to blame for the Flint water crisis? Well, when you boil it all down, folks, simply put, it's the resident voter of the city of Flint. They elected the filthy, corrupt scumbags into office, and they are still doing it. Here's an article from MLive. This tells you, this is 2013, ladies and gentlemen. Flint voters elect two convicted felons to the city council. And if you're going to elect convicted felons to the city council, you're going to vote those people in after you were trying to get rid of corrupt people. What's going to happen? More corruption is going to happen. Newly elected Flint City Council includes a convicted killer, a man who served probation for felonious assault, and two other people who have had bankruptcies. That's not a big issue. We all face financial difficulties in our life. But how, if the resident voter of Flint does their work, how can they elect a convicted killer or a man who served probation for felonious assault? If you're not going to do your homework, if you're not going to pay attention to who you're electing, and if you think electing these kind of people are the kind of people you want to elect, then you're going to get corruption and your city's going to fall apart. When this whole water crisis started in 2015, they had the idea of throw the bums out, but they elected a convicted killer. Was that a move to get a more honest politician in office? What was the goal there? Did you guys look into who you might be voting? It might take some time, I understand. But look what has happened because the people of Flint did not do their diligent work over the past two generations. The city of Flint has been run by Democratic Socialists for nearly two generations. Just like its big brother Detroit, and there's no denying it. Go look at all the mayors and the city council members. A overwhelming majority were left-wing Democrat socialists. The auto industry being run out of town, the tax base also left, a crumbling infrastructure. And when all that happens, what do the voters of a city do? They get mad because they get screwed over by the politician. They find out the politician's a liar and a scumbag. And they get mad about it and they want to file a class action lawsuit because their kids got sick. Well, look in the mirror. The reason your kids are getting sick is because you trusted a politician. Plain and simple. This is what happens when you want socialism. Flint is no different than Detroit in the fact that they were run by Democratic Socialists for decades, for generations, and they crumbled. The industries were driven out of the city. The tax base left. It's the same story. And the only reason Detroit hasn't had a water issue is because they're lucky enough to have, guess what? The Detroit River right there. And they don't have to pump it all the way to Flint. That's a lot of water that's got to be pumped out to Flint. Anytime problems occur within a government, we see them cover it up. We see them distract. We see this all the time. And we continue to vote for the same types of people to replace those people. This is a larger problem. We have seen state, local, federal government all fail in this crisis. All fail. Who runs the governments? We either get Republican or Democrat. That's it. And everybody continues to vote Republican or Democrat. That's it. And we continue to have problems at the local level, at the state level, at the federal level, with corruption, with lying. But we continue to vote for the two parties and the problems are never solved. And in fact, they continue to grow. My advice to the people of Flint is simple. Get the hell out. Get out. Let that city crumble. You do not want to be part of that city anymore. Get out as fast as you can. This is not going to be the last crisis in Flint. Do you want to be part of the next one? I don't think so. Your best bet, get out, find a better place to live, and when you get there, start researching the people you vote for. And if they're corrupt, don't put them in office. You can't elect a killer to your city council and expect things to turn out good. Would you elect a rapist to your city council? The problem is with the people and how they vote, and they expect things from the government. Nobody was prepared for this. Nobody. And people get mad because they weren't prepared. They weren't prepared for their water to be contaminated. What if it wasn't lead in the city's problem? What if it was a terrorist attack and they contaminated all the water? Who are you going to blame then?
Don't touch that dial. John LeBang Show will be right back.
You can bet on it, man.
It's on you, people. You, as an individual, need to prepare and stop relying on these charlatan politicians who let you down all the time without exception. Well, we're running long. Again, here I went, talked for a whole hour. 60 minutes gone by, boom, in a blink of an eye. Hope you found tonight's show informative. You may not agree with my conclusion.
T-minus 10, 9,
but I don't know.
7, 6, 5.
The facts are there for you, people.
3, 2, 1.
It's up to you.
We have liftoff.
It's up to you. See you next week, right here on the John LeBang Show.
Tune in again next week. Same time, same space, same station.
Resistance is futile.
Hey man, listen to the John LeBang Show, man. every Wednesday at 3 p.m. British Standard Time, man, on WRFN, man, 1025. Don't say I didn't warn you, man.
Yes, to the Johnny Bang Show. Listen,
are you for real?
You're listening to the John LeBang Show, right here on Vulcan Sound Radio.
Are you sure you're in the right place?
Hey man, the John LeBang Show owns the weekend, man.
Get your ass in gear.
Listen to the John LeBang Show, man, every Saturday at 8 p.m. and Sunday at 8 p.m., man.
Don't miss an episode.
He's the weekend dude.